Доброе утро.
Good morning. Well, yet another very exciting day is about to start at the Startup Village. Yesterday, everything ended exactly in the way it was supposed to finish, by concert. Well, today everything shall be completed by yet another concert. I would like to say at the outset, it would be Elsie Popson Jazz Band from St. Petersburg. And once the final competition is over, that shall be started at 3 p.m., when 21 finalists shall present their pitch session and their companies, and would probably make a lot of money because the investors and rich capitalists from all around the world will be among the audience. After that, the concert shall start, Elder Poppins and New Look Jazz Band. Apart from that, close to the final concert, the Prime Minister Dmitry Medvedev ready for join us. Those who are willing to see him, don't miss it. Prime Minister of the Russian Federation live today with us, Dmitry Medvedev, and his deputy Arkady Dvorkovich, and one more deputy, Igor Shuvalov. But all that is coming ahead, and now we're going to name the finalists. Almost 250 companies competed yesterday in their pitch battles, competing for the right to get a big prize and a right to go to the FIFA World Cup in Brazil. Well, I believe you understand, many failed, and just 21 company is going to change our future. They're going to compete on this stage and shall compete for the main prize, 900,000 rubles. But all of them have received 150,000 rubles already, and I'm ready to name the finalists. Is the technological service ready to name them? Okay, let us start. Baby Step Corporation.
Conceptor.
Institut.
Della. Let's chant for the rich. Let's sympathize with the poor. Microflexis.
Nano-optica.
Yeah, I would cross these out. Gamma locator. Igeo.
Colibri Catu.
Mobile videos, video solutions.
Personalizированный подход.
Personalized approach to treat endometriosis. Radio gigabit. Resilica.
Robo CV.
Santa Farm.
Start Catalyst.
Technology Market. DTG Labs.
free at last.
Only diagnosis of various diseases.
Exorobotics,
exoathlete. Well, guys, the calculation, the computation shows us that if we have 21 companies multiplied by 150,000 rubles that we promised all them, the Skolko Foundation would be stripped of around 3 million rubles. But the beauty is that you paid for the admission, and it's your money that we're going to indulge on. Now, Nanooptica Reflexes, our Exorobotics, Exoathlete, Market Technology Center, Farm Concept, Start Catalyzer, Robo CV, Mobile Video Solutions, Freight Last, Tetagalaps, Center for Early Diagnosis of Neurogenological Diseases, Gamma Catarazilica, Calibri Gattu, Baby Step Corporation, Personalized Approach to Treating Endometriosis, Radio Gigabit, and my loved, beloved one, Well, who called the company this difficult, this complicated various environments to treat diamonds? Are these people here? Can you imagine? Can you imagine just the shelf with their product? I wonder what their product is. Immersive ambiences. You just come to a supermarket and ask, where do you have immersive ambiences to study diamonds properties? And the sales assistant tells you, oh, it's in groceries. Immerse almas. Why not call them immerse diamond or flawed ambience? What do we have? Second list. So we don't have the finalists here right now. So I have congratulated all them. Motivating speech. I haven't prepared any motivating speech. And the executive director, managing director of the cluster of biomed technology, Kiel KM, and Frederick Boucher, say chair, are welcomed on stage. And they are to tell us something in a succinct manner. It's of pleasure that not the biomedical cluster has the most difficult title, so we have some room for advancement. And it's a pleasure for me that today we award the interesting projects. We will also have an opportunity to invite our partners. Prix Galien is an international prize award for medical machinery, medical equipment. It's one of the major relevant missions, events in America. And now I'd like to yield to my colleague. I speak a bit Russian. Thank you so much. But I'll switch into English.
The prize is the oldest and most respected pharmaceutical award in the world. It's 44 years old. It comes from France. And we organized it in Russia for the first year, for the first time last year. Skolkovo is one of our partners in order to identify projects in Russia in the field of biopharmaceutical and biomedical research, and we are very happy to have this partnership with Skolkovo Innovation Fund. What we have decided...
Sorry, I would interrupt you because I see a lot of people are without synchro.
means they speak English.
Да.
Okay.
Конечно, это новое покажение.
Okay.
So what will happen this year is that we have created a special award, which we will call the Startup Award, where all the finalists, all the laureates from the startup village will have a chance to run and submit a file, to our jury. This file will be evaluated by the jury from a scientific and innovation point of view only, so it's very different from what you're doing. It's not market size. It's really from the innovation and the scientific point of view, and they will choose one winner, and we'll be very happy to invite that winner to the Galien Award ceremony, which will take place in the Pashkov House on the 23rd of October this year. It's a very prestigious award. Pharmaceutical companies pay up to 12,000 euros just to come and sit down at the award. And it's a beautiful evening. Many big pharma companies there, many academicians there. Last year we had up to 30 academicians and key opinion leaders who were present in the room. And I wish all of you good luck.
Can we have two extra invitations? Just
for...
Yes, yeah.
Should I answer now? You know, it's a bit the knife and the... Yeah,
менее, of course. Я, краткий wrap-up сделаю.
No, nevertheless, a short wrap-up. It's been long since we have seen this award presented, and it's been for 3 years in this country, and there is a medical equipment nomination this year, and novelty and projects are looked at from the perspective of science and innovation. Galien is not dealing with the market component, with the market value and prospects, but all those five pre-finalists will be submitted automatically to the jury of the Prix Galien, and the best company will be nominated, and it might get the award, but anyway, you will be invited to the gala dinner, and which I remind you costs 12,000 euros to attend. So this is one of our five. We hope that one of our five projects will at least be invited to the dinner.
For those of you who would be interested in the future to run for the Prix Galien, even though they haven't maybe won here today, we have categories which are open for research programs, and I can only invite you to contact you or
Thank
me
you.
Directly in the future to inquire about how you can participate in this award and become a candidate.
Да, это премия ежегодная, соответственно, можно контактировать.
This is an annual prize. You can contact Skolkova if you want to commercialize your project, if it's in the pipeline, or you can turn to Prix Galien if it is an early stage, and this year is going to be held, the ceremony is going to be held in October, so you can, don't miss it. So next item on our agenda, what is the next item on our agenda, I wonder? Sectional sessions, nanomaterials, is it to be held here? Yes, nanomaterials are so small, so don't go too far, otherwise you will not be able to see them. Good day, my name is Sergey Mulazimov. I rose Technology Marvel program on NTV channel is where I am an anchor, the anchor, and today we'll speak of marvels and miracles that are still in the pipeline. And some days ago I received news that the mystery why our batteries get recharged and lose their capability in the course of time. So this mystery has been disclosed. It's about the structure of the lithium plates. What are they made of? I don't know. Oxide comprising plates, and they accumulate fatigue. And there are some micro defects that make us think that our smartphone is worth nothing. And we either replace the battery or throw the smartphone into the dustbin. So these are things at a very nano micro level. And if we look into them, this can change all our life. And the course of these studies is to be briefed by our panelists, Artem Aganov, despite his young and flourishing age. He's a professor at New York State University. I was there not long ago. It's situated in the Long Island. Everybody knows the cocktail, right? It's a marvelous place not far from New York. Artyom deals with crystallography, and today he will tell us what it is and how on earth shall we see these changes in the 21st century thanks to this field of physics. Ruslan Yanusov, head of Russian Quantum Center, with the assistance of Skolkovo, this center deals with the state-of-the-art research of new materials. We keep hearing that computers will become even more powerful in their computing capability because of the quantum technologies, and Ruslan knows a lot about this. And his presentation will be focused on the invisible man. And we'll be able to create an invisible man thanks to the quantum technologies. And Sergei Netruk is a technical director, CTO of 3M. 3M is a company. Well, you know, once I learned about this company, about its existence, I started noting it's everywhere. In South Korea, I put a protective mask and it has 3M brand on it. So this company is omnipresent, ubiquitous. It uses state-of-the-art solutions and new materials, state-of-the-art materials, and provides packaged solutions and off-the-box, off-the-shelf products. Artyom, the floor is all yours. So what awaits us in the 21st and 22nd probably centuries? Thank you. I have prepared some slides, I hope. They will help you understand what I'm going to be saying. First of all, I'd like to say that the discovery of new materials is absolutely necessary for technology advancement. You can't create a new technology without having a new material with properties on top of the existing average. And up to the recent time, and including the recent time, new materials have been discovered by either trial and error, when you want to search for a new material and start sifting through various options of compounds. You get one compound, it's not fit, you get another, it's not fit again, you throw it away, and you may spend 1,000 attempts. You might find the material, you might not. This is the trial and error, one of the two domineering prevailing methods. And second is just good luck, like Freon was searched for, and they found it to Flown. Hypertension drug search gave us Viagra, and so the trial and error method is called Edison's method. And Edison was one of the main and most successful and luckiest inventors. He discovered 10,000 methods that did not work, is the saying. And now in the modern world, we cannot use these two methods because we need a fast and reliable and error-free method to find new materials. It must be, we must hit the bullseye. From the first time, it must be a scientific and academic approach. Predicting new materials, well, we entrust our computers with this task. We turn our computers on and want to predict new materials in a reliable way, but to be able to predict it, we need to predict the structure of the material, like the graphite and diamond. On the right we have graphite, on the left we have diamond. This is carbon anyway, but the properties, one is super hard, the other is super soft, one is transparent, the other is not. So if you know the structure, you can predict the properties the material is going to have. The correlation between the structure and the properties is well seen in biology. Like understanding the DNA structure helps us understand the genetics. And there may be very many examples. This year has been declared by the International Year of Crystallography. 100 years ago, people learned to decipher crystal structures of materials. It was one of the great breakthroughs that can be compared to the quantum theory, to the theory of relevance, and we have been able to understand the conduct and behavior of living and non-living systems. And anyway, all what we know about modern science bases on knowing the structure of substance, of material. If you don't know the structure, you should predict the future structure of the future material. Up to now, it was deemed to be an impossible task. You can see here horrible, horrible figures, 10 in the power of 39. A single computer would be able to search for and sift through this great number of structures, but we've been able to solve the task with the help of evolutionary or revolutionary crystallography. This was the citation of our colleagues, revolutionary instead of evolutionary. So we can solve the really infinite tasks within a finite period of time of computing. Thus, we were produced by evolution out of a small group of atoms. A human being appeared. We have gathered and raised funding, more than $30 billion. We have a very reliable and professional team, and now we have a huge program, and around 2,000 people and scholars and scientists are using it. So how do we do it, and what have we already predicted? Like, if we rely on the quantum mechanics only and want to predict new materials, it means that you don't depend on the human prejudices and knowledge, and you can predict very often some things that a human being cannot even think of, and find new phenomena that are in breach of the laws of nature. So the computer can predict these, and the human being cannot, because he or she can't conceive such things. Just we have small clips. So it's predicting the structure of carbon under high and extra high pressure. Click the left, please. Out of nothing, out of a mixture of atoms, you can't play on the left one. So we get structures that can be proven experimentally. The left clip won't play, but the structure of the diamond is to appear finally, I hope. There's a glitch of the computer, but on the right-hand side we can see a movie clip on. It's playing. We had hundreds of publications with the use of the method. Very many companies resort to it. But let me tell you a couple anecdotes. It's expected that at high pressure, the chemical properties are to change, and we cannot predict what direction will the change take. If the chemical properties are changing, we can get new materials with unique properties. This is confirmed by our research. Natrium under high pressure. Natrium is a classical metal. It will become transparent, and the sodium will become transparent and crystal clear. Indeed, it has become transparent. Here is the result. It allows for sun rays to pass through it. Once I was walking around the campus of my university and I was looking down, I was thinking about something, and I saw this flag, and it says that one of the greatest inventions is that that transparent form of sodium was discovered, and this is huge indeed. This is indeed a huge achievement. Yeah, indeed. Congratulations. But what follows from this? Like a genie out of the bottle, we can see very many phenomena appearing, chemical phenomena appearing. So what is the sodium chloride formula? What about sodium 2 chloride? Who had a D in chemistry at school? Those with D grades can celebrate their victory, because under pressure such structures can appear. This is sodium chlorine 7. A chemistry teacher at school will go crazy. We know what salt is. It's a crystal. It can be white, it can be yellow, it can be blue sometimes, but anyway, mostly it's colorless and appears to be white. We know that atoms can be charged. Chlorine can have only the negative charge. Natrium can have the positive charge, and there should be the balance between them, one and one. Sodium gives out an electron, and chlorine receives it. But if we change the alignment of these elements, this stability of the structure is changed. When the salt is in yellow or in blue color, the alignment is indeed shifted, but it's a very minor shift, very minor breach of alignment. At ambient conditions, natrium chlorine is the only possible thing, only possible compound. If we increase the pressure, we can see very many variants and options, and chemistry teachers go crazy. And new physical states appear. Natrium 3 chlorine is a 2D metal, is what appears. So electrons can only go along the blue layers. They can't flow in another direction. It's an analog of graphene. It was proved experimentally, and long ago we've made it public in the Science magazine. So chemistry says that helium is the most inert element. It comprises 1/4 of the universe in terms of mass. So it's important to understand the conduct of helium. But anyway, it can respond to something, can respond to sodium. Sodium becomes even more active under pressure than in ambient conditions. And natrium to helium is a transparent compound under pressure, that appears under pressure. So everything, all the laws of chemistry are turned upside down. But anyway, we have the experimental proof. But if we introduce oxygen, we had to invent something and think using our gray matter before switching on the computer. So if we inject oxygen, there is a great degree of stabilization appears. Na2HeO is what appears, and it can be quite stable at the pressure, under the pressure of 13 pascals. So these exotic laws of chemistry, do they apply for everyday life? Yes, they do. We've been able to predict stable compounds at ambient conditions, at regular conditions. CSF2, CSF3, CSF5, and have patented these compounds. They are stable at normal conditions. Chemistry specialists have not seen them, but we have predicted that they're going to be stable. And fluorine can be transported. The fluorine, the most aggressive gas, can be transported with the help of this compound. It's quite light, this fluorine. Fluorine can be transported. The fluorine can be transported in a bag with the help of our material, and no one will suffer. You just heat it a bit and it disappears, evaporates. Teflon needs fluorine to be produced. And how to get the fluorine and how to bring it, deliver it to the factory with the help of our technology. The surface of the substance is characterized by this exotic chemistry laws, because very many links between atoms are broken. Nearly half of these links and ties are broken between atoms. And on the surface, we can see the appearance of unexpected compounds and new 2D crystal structures or lattices.
I'm absolutely sure that you all have heard that people who work a lot with the opalescence know that there's a very high opportunity that those who work with it might die of pulmonary cancer. Those who breathe in a lot of dust and the quantum quartz dust die of the same thing. Why? They seem the both the asbestos and the quartz seem to be the ones that are not the oxides, and the classical oxide in the biochemistry is a peroxide. So where does it come from? And it turns out that on the surface, these two chemically neutral substances, these active peroxides emerge, and therefore the surface of the substances might have a completely different chemical qualities as compared to the substance itself and might be quite aggressive and toxic. We actively develop this issue, and it even might be that we come to understand that the way to get rid of these toxic qualities. Getting away from the high-pressure environment to the normal substances, well, we have a lot of gaps here as well. It turns out that the chemistry experts simply forgot about the very stable chemical compound that you see on the screen. The MnB3 was tested by us. We went to the laboratory, we tested it, we mixed it in a ratio 1:3, and we had this composition. And nobody has never mentioned it, have never noticed it for almost 300 years. And the computers enable us to forecast existence of new compounds that never existed before. Can something be harder than a diamond? Well, people are looking for almost 50 years for a substance harder than the diamond. Well, our calculation demonstrates that it is not possible. Although we can get pretty close to that, you cannot create anything that would be harder than that. But there is a whole number of substances that can be almost as hard as a diamond. Well, everything I wanted to do is to give you just a taste of what we're dealing with. I wanted to demonstrate that the design of new materials using computer is possible. It is something that we do already today, that we can forecast the materials with the broadest scope of qualities, and it is very reliable. And sometimes the computer might forecast something that you might not even think about, and is later proved in the laboratory testing. I also would like to mention a couple of projects that we are leading. Unfortunately, I don't have to cover it, but we are making ways of making strong magnets that is a multi-billion industry. There is no a single magnet that does not have the rare earth components. And I think China is the one that sets the trend there. Is it possible to create strong magnets by getting rid of the rare earth materials? Well, in fact, it is possible, and the very first developments are on the screen. The work on creation of new pharmaceuticals, this is something that we also work on. And this is one of the pharmaceuticals that is under development right now. New polymers, namely the polymers with a high dielectric non-conductor component. And this is our latest project that even I'm a bit afraid of. This is an attempt to forecast the structure of proteins. It would enable us to go deep into the essence of different diseases and means to avoid it. Or you might create the artificial life. Well, that is not very likely. Can you please click on the top right corner of the slide, and you will see how the structure of the protein is being changed in the calculation and how the new correct structure emerges. But these are minor proteins. We are just getting ready, but within a year or half a year, we'll be able to foresee and predict very complicated structures of the proteins and would be of interest to the pharmaceutical industry. I would like to say the following. Computer design of new materials is the day we leave, and this is tomorrow. This is a revolution. This is something that was never possible several days before. It would enable us to make a great leap ahead in development of new materials and new technologies. We don't simply create new materials. We reconsider the rules and laws of chemistry. We expand them, and we generate new ideas that enables us to take a new look on the existing world. So it means new materials and new chemistry for the future. And I would like to work the employees of my three laboratories in Russia, United States, and China. And thank you for your attention. Thank you very much. This is absolutely unbelievable. This is something you do. These are the great tests with the compression of substances under great pressure. It might sound strange, but I remember pretty well the story how the Nobel Prize laureates Gehman and Vasilov made their discovery and received this Nobel Prize award using the tape. They managed to stratify the graphite plates, and by doing so, by using simply tape, they managed to create unique materials with unbelievable qualities. Graphene, the most fashionable substance right now, and the latest news of that also says that British scientists receive large number of graphene using the kitchen blender, and another group managed to disperse them using the ultrasound. And it might be a scalable business, and soon the graphene might change our future. And by the way, talking about the kitchen blender, I think somebody should stop British scientists. Well, in fact, I love them. They provide lots of things to talk about for my TV show. I don't know what I have done without them. Life would be boring. That is true. Well, I wish you follow the into the footprints of Gehman and Novoselov, and we are looking forward to learn that yet another Russian scientist receives a Nobel Prize. Well, Gehman started with the fact that he received a Schnobel Prize. Yes, that's exactly what I'm talking about. Well, you shouldn't pay attention to any kind of some strange thing that somebody might laugh at from the outside. Do you know what was the fact that he received a Schnobel Prize? He did some testing of the flight of a frog in a strong magnetic field. Well, that's the nature of sciences. Thank you very much. Ruslan Yunusov represents the Russian Quantum Center, and I promise that you're going to talk about the invisible man. Well, I would rather talk of an invisible cloak. Okay, that will do. We agree to that. So, in fact, I talked to Artyom before the beginning of this session, and it turned out that we have a lot in common. People are working on tackling the same goal, and very often when computer was invented, many people were quite euphoric. We're going to calculate everything. Well, now we have a number of tasks that stops us. We cannot solve them, and people start thinking what to do next. And Artyom was talking very excitingly about this breakthrough that was made in chemistry in order to tackle the goals that cannot be tackled that easily. Well, I'm going to talk about the breakthrough in physics and physics. And another approach to the task that Artyom is solving, he already has certain results. So we only have a vision that in the future we might get lucky. Let us talk about the materials and development of civilization. Well, it actually can be compared with the usage of materials that we use. And talking about the Stone Age, the Iron Age, they are characterized by the fact that people learned to use what was on the very surface that exists in nature and use it as a means of labor. Talking about the 20th century, we had quantitative changes compared to the Iron Age. But what happened to the materials? Well, very interesting things were happening to them. People came up with new materials, the age of polymers, the age of plastics, something that does not exist in nature, but all that is still classics. We learned to create very ecological and pure materials, silicon plates that are being actively used in the semiconductors industry. That kind of silicon does not create in nature. It is being created under certain artificial conditions, and that is a certain achievement. But if we look even further, what kind of materials can we find? Well, I would like to talk about meter materials. Well, that is a very peculiar thing. I think it's a breakthrough in physics in a standard meaning of the world. Well, let us take a world. Look, meter materials, this is not a new chemical substance or not a new molecule. It is some kind of structure that was gathered in a particular way, conducted over certain elements that demonstrate a certain structure. And these are bricks of meter materials. If we talk about light meter materials, they are to be compared to the length of a light wave around 10 nanometers, which is strongly bigger than the molecules and atoms. So by creating that kind of structures, we might reach and create unbelievable qualities that are unreachable in nature. Here is a couple of examples of meter materials. If we talk about optics, by combining the layers of metals and non-conductors, we might have a negative deflection index, which is a nonsense for physics. Again, at school, everybody will tell you that you're a fool if you say something like this. Using that kind of elements, you can do the following. You can break the diffraction limit, diffraction boundary. We all know that a standard microscope enables you to take a look at the cell, or if you go even deep and you want to take a look at the DNA spiral, you won't succeed because the length of a wave of light is longer than that. So light passes through without noticing it. By using meter materials, we can compress the light and take a look beyond the light boundary. Like here, around 15 nanometers of compression, this is 10 times less than the object that you normally can see. So this is the kind of application that is coming to the industry today, and they are at the very border of this technology. Another thing that we were talking about is the invisibility cloak. Unfortunately, not an invisible man so far, but these are the subjects around 1 centimeter, and we can create some kind of a cover, a coating. And using that, if we consider this ball made of a meter material and it is shallow inside, you can put within it anything and you will not be able to see this thing within this coating, no matter from which point you look at it, because you can take a look at the light waves, it just covers this and get back to its trajectory. So if you are looking right in front of this invisibility cloak, you cannot see anything behind it. It would be all great, you could go to a shop and buy it. There is one problem. So far, we managed to do that only for a very narrow interval of the wave, just for one color. We can do that for green color, we can make it invisible, and red. But it won't work in the white light. In any case, these are the things that are absolutely impossible in nature. There are certain analogs. Let's say the effect of the pearl or the pattern of a butterfly wing. They do not exist of different colors. They consist of very similar elements. Let's say some cuttings that are made on the metal. If you make certain cuttings compared to the length of a wave, we might have very unusual and peculiar effects. It might get dark or black or change the color. So it can be used here. Second sphere of usage, something that we would like to use, is again all about calculations, because we live in an age of digital technologies and calculation. And I think you all have noticed that normal electronics is no longer developing for about 5 to 7 years. The rapidness of processes is not increasing. Everybody is looking for multi-core system, not because multi-core means a lot, but one core is no longer growing. If you say 2 megahertz, now we have computers working 1,000 times faster, and even our smartphones are much faster than the computers back then. So yes, the frequency is increasing, but that's it, and is no longer growing because the limit of 10 gigahertz stops everything. So what should be done? We might use completely different technologies. Let's say the frequency of light is 10 and power of 15. So if we learned how to tackle light and manage light in this way, we would have an increase by 1,000 times. But it is hard to manage light this way. But there are certain optic elements available. And by the way, another advantage of standard electronics is that you can make very small sub-objects of 10 nanometers. And in order to combine and make them work together, you have to invent something. And this here of this kind of compilation is again in meter materials. And here is an example of a plasmon waveguide. It is a quite complicated system, but the light goes through this crack between these two metals. It is compressed there and gets 10 times, the frequency gets 10 times smaller, and you can combine the electronic and the photon method. The first chip of the kind is already created. It is an IBM chip. And at the very bottom of the slide, you can see a photo marked in blue, the optic waveguide, and in yellow, the copper conductor. So it would be indeed yet another breakthrough in productivity. So I was talking about the optic meter materials. But as we know, light can be used in radio waves and in microwaves. And you can manage it as well. And by the way, that kind of research in the optic light was done by a member of the consultative union of Skolkova, Mr. Shalaev. We cooperate with them actively. And we have two groups dealing with this research. One of them is dealing with semi-photon sources of light. And they're dealing with very similar plasmon effects. And the third group is the group guided by Alexei Ustinov. They are trying to do the same, but in the microwave band. It is not enough just to do certain cuttings on the metal. Each particular element there is a part of an electronic circuit in liquid helium when the temperature is around zero. It is a superconductivity and the current is constantly on. But that kind of system enables to manage the light in the microwave band in a way that was never possible before. So it is a very extensive and exciting industry. Many people invest their effort and money there, and we expect a lot of success there. Coming back to the previous method that Artyom was talking about, he agrees to the fact that you cannot solve this issue in one lump, and he has a very interesting evolutionary approach that brings certain results. We have a purely physical approach to that. We were not the one to invent it. So the goal of quantum simulation is around 50 years old when there was a desire to do that when the laser was invented. But we're getting closer to that of the last 10 to 20 years. What is the essence of that? If you think of the materials available, everybody wants to have small superconductors and the level of magnetism that is very strong without rare earth metals. So the physics says that in order to understand what you have to do, you have to understand how it works. Talking about crystal structures and grids, we have nodes of the crystals and the electrons moving between them. If we can describe the movement of the electrons, everything is good. We can easily check what somebody brought to us and take a look at a particular crystal. You don't not have to work on the synthesis of it for several months. You can take a look immediately and say whether it fits or not. The problem is that the simply modeling on a supercomputer might provide for the modeling, or let's say 40 spins. And for that kind of a fact, it would be good to have several hundreds. By adding 10 more elements, you make the goal 1,000 more complicated. Therefore, it is not an easy nut to crack. So what do we do in our laboratories? And one of the laboratories is being constructed here in Skolkovo. If you cannot calculate or do the synthesis, you can simulate. You can create a system consisting of completely different items, but that would behave in exactly the same manner as the system we want to study. And we found that kind of approach. If we take a properly prepared ultra-cold atom around 1 millionth part of the degree by Kelvin, very close by an absolute zero, and allocate it in a space in a manner that we need, then they would interact and behave exactly in a way they would behave in the crystalline grid that we need. The problem is to fix them so that they do not fly apart in different directions. And we found the technological solution for that. We can create a picture. You can see it on the right side of the slide. The laser standing wave is quite strong there. And if we launch several lasers ahead and several from the sides, we would have a picture of interferential that you have. You can see at the bottom of the slide. And most interestingly, individual atoms remain within the nodes of this grid. They cannot fly away. And if we carefully select the lasers and do different pictures, we can create a model of a particular crystal without doing any calculation. We can measure the characteristics and receive a result. And as in any idea, it is important to implement it. But so far, technical implementation means dozens or hundreds of particles. But it is clear how to move on. Here is an example of that kind of utility. There is a camera at the top, lasers, and the cloud of ultra-cold atoms is gathered there. We fix them in space, and we see what we have. This is yet another approach when you cannot solve the issue immediately, but still want to do something. Well, we will soon create a time machine. Well, I think there is something that contradicts us to that. But as we know, there is nothing impossible, and it turns out that not everything that we learn at school is correct. Yes. The peculiarity of quantum physics is that it breaks your conscience completely, because certain things that seems obvious to us, let's say the simple thing like wave dualism, a wave or a particle or photon or electron, and it turns out that there is no such separation. And in one experiment, you can measure one quality. In a different experiment, you can measure different quality. And it doesn't go together. And we talk about the complication. And even Nobel Prize laureates say, OK, shut up and calculate. It better not try and explain everything. So many efforts were made in vain. But to no avail, there is no proper interpretation. And one of the most popular ideas is the idea of parallel universes. It can explain at least something. Well, some people are getting extremely anxious and say, shut up and calculate. Just solve the equation, and we have a clear result. Thank you very much. We wish you good luck in your research. And I hope that all of that, or at least part of it, would be used in our computers. And our phones would open YouTube not in 3 seconds, but in 1 second. And we would enjoy all the advantages of new technologies. Everything that we're talking about by two previous speakers is something that others are trying to commercialize and bring to us, to consumers, namely the 3M company, American company, is trying to do that. And the technical director of the Russian rep office is Sergei Dmitruk. Sergei, please tell us what awaits us in the future, and how do you find, from all the diversity of sometimes crazy projects, you find the ones that you can truly commercialize and the ones that are really worth attention and should be implemented and create the beautiful earplugs that we use in very loud environment? Well, I'll try to share the mechanism of innovations implementation in 3M. Just a couple words on our company. 3M is a global company. Two-thirds of its business is located beyond the United States, which is a home country to this company. And despite the fact that the company is 112 years old, it is a very dynamic company. And over the last 5 years, the shares of 3M provided a one and a half time faster growth than S&P 500 index. We have around 10,000 people working in R&D. And the activity of these people is well acknowledged. Over the last 3 years, 3M has been acknowledged by Booz & Co. as one of three most innovative companies of the world. And 3M is well known as a company that manufactures a lot of practically applicable, beautiful innovations rather than several, but really huge. And there is always an issue. How possibly in a company you can create very different project, let's say medical plasters or chemistry against corrosion, some chemical substance against corrosion, or LED lamp? Well, I'll try to clarify that. Well, first of all, 3M defines its technological opportunities as 46 technological platforms and creation of new products. It includes development of each particular platform and constant interaction of these platforms. And I can illustrate that on two cases. The technology of non-woven materials. I think you're all aware of the insulator Tinsulate, which is one of examples of the kind, and micro-replication technology. This is a process of creation of an absolutely identical micro object and its allocation in a particular geometrical order in a particular carrier. For the first time, the micro replication was used in 1960s for manufacturing of Fresnelli lenses that replaced heavy and expensive lenses on the micro projectors and made them available for the consumers and massive consumption. And once the micro prisms were used in this process, the light reversing film was created with a very efficient coefficient of returns due to the fact that it decreases the number of deflection. So let's say the car lights would be distracted in a very clear way back to the driver so that the driver could easily see the road signs during the nighttime. We also combine this technology of micro replication with extrusion technology. And we provided a form of mushrooms to our objects. And we created a very special clip that is being actively used in different technologies. And it provided for a new innovative product, a system for multi-channel injections of pharmaceuticals. Simultaneously, our company is considering usage of this technology for its traditional sphere, namely abrasive materials. And through the efforts of dozens of laboratories, around 30 scientists, we have created an abrasive disc. And each pyramid of this abrasive disc creates of abrasive microcrystals that are absolutely alike. And whenever there is a contact with a particular material that is being brazed, there is a perfect roughness of the surface that you work on. And through the time of implementation of this product, two scientists of 3M received a prize from the American Technological Society. And by combining the technology of micro replication or the special technology for manufacturing of ceramic, we produced a totally new material in respect of the speed that you can tackle the material. It enables you to eliminate the metal, let's say, 3 or 4 times faster than a traditional crystal, and it has a quality of getting sharper through the action. The crystal decomposing through the time of usage, and the abrasive disc remains as sharp as it used to be. And the latest example of 3M. 3M is famous for its expertise in creation of multi-layer films, up to 30 layers in thickness of 3 to 5 microns. They are combined together, and when we used a special film with a micro replication inside of these layers, we had many different materials with very different chemical qualities. So let's say the screens that are used in the privacy filter for your private computers, personal computers, you can carefully see what you work on, but the person sitting next to you on the train or on the plane cannot see what is on your screen. As for the manufacturing application, it is LED displays, and it saves up to 30% of energy. And one of the latest novelties of our company is LCD lamp with equal light that can work for 25 years nonstop with energy consumption of 13 watts, and it provides for the same equivalent as the filament lamp for 30 years.
I wanted to show you the intertwining of technologies, the overlap of technologies. Similar examples could be cited for non-knit materials with abrasive particles, which gives a 3D abrasive substance for polishing, or materials for diapers. When the fiber has been replaced, now we have the carpets with a great deal of dirt absorption capability. And when we finally learned to put the electric charge on the fiber, we now can have very good filtering materials, like filtering masks, respirators, and filters for cars, saloons, air conditioning filters for households, etc. So we have an overlap of platforms, at the and the products are created in this overlap zones. And the technology mentioned is non-knit materials technology is present in 2/3 of all the products. And now I will brief you on the innovative principles of our company. To ensure for the mutual enrichment of technologies, the scientists, the researchers, should get access to all the technology. This is principle number one to innovation. And in terms of innovation, each of the researchers has an opportunity to use the groundwork of all other departments and divisions. The company has a corporate laboratory that develops proprietary technologies and laboratories of relevant and respective divisions that help commercialize these technologies and prepare them for commercialization. But anyway, anyone can use anything. And internal networking and cooperation is in the focus of our attention. Now, a couple of words on other principles of ours. The company says that the innovation is client-oriented, and it starts with the client. And it's not an advertising trick, no. One of the founders of the company spent a lot of time shopping and striking conversations with buyers on what they liked and what they did not like. And the main ideas are born with the clients, the customer insight notion, because we should listen to the client, to the insight of a specific client and the needs, and we could develop new astonishing solutions in a number of R&D development, R&D division of the company, talk to the clients and source innovations from them. Clients can every now and then visit the research laboratories and then participate in practical implementation of the ideas. Commercialization for us is a strictly prescribed process in phases. On each of the stages, we make decisions on the feasibility of further investment and the innovative capability for our company is measured as the ratio of products introduced to the market over the last 5 years versus the overall sales portfolio, and we have our own targets for this. And we use the 15% rule, so the time that each researcher can spend on tasks that have not been coordinated with his boss in advance. So this is an opportunity to strike the balance between creativity, flexibility, and discipline. This is how we see our innovative approach. And by way of wrapping up, I'd say that for 3M, innovation is our strategy, and the CEO keeps underlining it. And we praise our scientists, our researchers. This is Carlton Prize, Carlton Award, which is similar to Nobel Prize. It's awarded to the most deserving researchers. And here it's been given by the current and ex-CEO in the photos. And there is emphasis laid on the fact that praising the researchers, the effective researchers, is at the core of our strategy. Thank you. Thank you. I'd like to note two things. First of all those who have listened to the presentations of our speakers, especially Sergei, that of Sergei, will treat some things differently, like the things one wears, one administers, etc. So these new products have been the results of streamlining the processes and optimizing the properties. This is indeed huge underlying work. And by the way, we can hear the plethora of Chinese names. Artyom has very many members of his New York laboratory that originate from China, a plethora of them. So guys, in here we should catch up. We're lagging behind. Actually, in my laboratory in Moscow, I have several Chinese people and one Italian. So we're going global, we're getting global. We should stand up to the competition and try not to lose. I have a question to Artyom. He had a very interesting presentation about new avenues and new ways. What about high voltage charges? Have you monitored the change of properties? We have fertilizer for synthesized nitrogen in the field, and within several seconds, the air gases change their properties quite rapidly. Under the conditions of these supervoltaic charges, supervoltage charges. Well, in these new magnetic and electric fields, we will have very many new phenomena. And now we're having a pilot project looking at the strong electric fields and whether we could get new materials with rather low pressure, but at the expense of a strong electric field. And I believe that we will keep working on that, and it bears promise. Will anyone like to ask anything else? I can't see your hands here. Mic, please. Mic to the speaker. I missed the call. I came last, but I have a question to you. Do you have adhesive tape? Water resistant? What do you mean water? Water resistant, waterproof adhesive tape? I don't know. Do we have it or not? Well, yes, they exist. There exists such tape, such adhesive tape. You can call us and you will be briefed and advice will be provided. I saw it at the construction exhibition. Yeah. You'll be able to get it. I have a question to Artyom. In the late 80s, the research focused on high-temperature superconductors. In light of the new chemistry, have you made any advances? Because back in the 1990s, the topic was somewhat stalled or suspended overall and globally. Is it pursued now? Yes, the topic of research, the subject of research is existent now. And with respect to high voltage high temperature superconductors, there is one difficulty. There is no normal, real, feasible theory in place for them that would enable you to predict their properties building on the crystal lattice or crystal structure. And very many research teams have been working on that. It's not at all easy. And the team or the researcher who will elaborate the theory will get the Nobel Prize, I'm sure. Until we have this theory in place, it's no use predicting superconductors, high-temperature superconductors. On the day of the appearance of theory, of this theory, we'll be able to advance greatly. So we go through trial and error with, given the absence of this theory, or probably abrupt or sudden decisions. And these sudden decisions, accidental decisions, are, as of today, the most efficient method. And depending on the size of the atom that is introduced to the structure of the high-temperature superconductor, the superconductivity temperature can be altered. Thus, people thought that mercury containing superconductors could be created, and they were created and became the best performing conductors in terms of their conductivity, thermal conductivity. But this is probably the single example of some reasonable development in the field. The rest is lacking because we don't have a good theory, a sound theory in place. I confirm it that in the news we can hear that this group of researchers works on this and that group works on that. So when a lot of people think about the same issue and look into the same issue, anyway, sooner or later we'll get the result. Another question. You've been speaking about culinary topic. Just Watson discovered a new recipe, as I have learned today, and people liked the new taste, so probably You should use the same technology of deep learning. We don't need this technology. We don't use this technology. But now we're thinking of using the deep learning. Could you render the deep learning into Russian? There's a group, there's a spate of approaches related to artificial intelligence. These are self-learning algorithms. Another group of self-learning of artificial intelligence algorithms are neuron grids, comprising several layers to process the information. When you have very many layers, it's deep learning. And those neural nets or networks in the human brain contain around 10 layers to process visual images. And we're working on the deep learning, and probably we'll introduce it, and it will make our life easier. Thank you. We have depleted all our time, and the next session is waiting. Thank you so much.